It's time for Wretched Radio with Todd Friel.
Do you sometimes feel like Elvis?
No.
Regrets. I've had a few.
Then here's what you need to do.
But then again, too few to make.
This is 1977, by the way.
I'm sorry, Elvis.
What I had to do and saw it through without.
You need to put things behind you. You need to forget what lies behind. Strain forward to what looks ahead. Is that what that verse means? Oh, let's see what Elvis has got, man.
Yes, there were times I'm sure you knew. When I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, through Elvis' doubts, I didn't spit out. I faced it all.
Gotta tell you. It's kind of sad to look at, I don't mind telling you. 9 years earlier, it was 1968. Then 1977 came, and Elvis, well, he fell apart. So let's forget what lies behind Elvis and strain forward to what lies ahead. Have you got some bad memories? Regrets. We've all had a few. And the memories, they're pressed between the pages of your mind, and you keep opening that book, and you perhaps
have
been told.
Why do you sound like a bad Nashville song lyric? I'm just asking.
That was actually another Elvis lyric. It's Elvis Day. Philippians 3:13 has been perhaps applied to you to help you to forget those bad things. Just forget them. Think about the future. Don't think about the past. Just think about the future. Is that good advice? Yes. Yes, it is. Is it biblical? To a degree, it is. We look forward to heaven. We realize we live in a veil of tears, but we don't have to forget the past. Whatever bad memories you have, this is not a mind game to just forget what lies behind and just think about the future. Because there's many reasons for this, that we want to remember the swamp out of which Jesus pulled us. We don't want to forget even those awful things, because as we do that, we forget how much God has done to rescue us. Furthermore, we don't want to do that because that is not what the text says. What was Paul forgetting? Bad memories, recollections, actions, failures. Context is what matters. The context of Philippians 3 is going to be the source that informs us what Paul was forgetting, because we don't want to misapply a Bible verse. And you might be inclined to think at the moment, well, I like that. I mean, it's good advice. Yes, it is good advice to be thinking about heaven, not just God has a wonderful plan for my life, but to be thinking about heaven, that's appropriate and right. But this verse is not intended to give us a mind swipe, to etch-a-sketch our brains. Just forget about it, forget about it. So what was Paul after? This from No Able Word. Or Knowable Word. Either way, knowableword.com, Peter Kroll. Context matters. Never read a Bible verse. He has some good advice in this article, and this is more than just understanding this particular text right. It is understanding how it is that we go about and read the Bible. He writes, when we learn to read the Bible properly and not merely as a collection of sound bites or independent proverbial sayings, that happens all the time. When we read it rightly, you might discover that some very familiar verses mean something a little different than the way they have been applied in the past. The statement, forgetting what lies behind, strain forward to what lies ahead, that's only a part of a longer sentence. here's the whole thing. But one thing I do, said Paul, forgetting what lies behind, straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. That's instructive already, isn't it? Because he's telling us, I'm forgetting certain things. I'm leaving those things behind, not forgetting them. I'm not pursuing those things. Instead, I am pressing toward a different goal. So this isn't all memories. This already, inside of the one sentence, tells us he's after something very specific here. So he's saying, I'm forgetting what lies behind. I'm straining forward to what lies ahead. And what lies ahead is the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. The one thing that he's talking about, this is the one thing I'm after, getting to heaven, being with Jesus Christ. That's what I'm after. The upward call, walking like him, thinking like him, that automatically, I believe, limits the what lies behind. Because Paul wouldn't make a broad statement, I forget everything I've ever done so I can think about being sanctified and going to heaven. That doesn't even make sense, does it? This is from Philippians 3:13a. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own. Okay, so that's the statement inside of Philippians 3:13 that precedes our sentence. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own. That should cause us to go, what is he talking about here? What is it? What's the thing that Paul has not yet made his own? Go back another sentence. Not that I have already obtained this, but I press on to make it my own. What is he talking about? He's pressing on for something, the prize of the upward call, but we don't know what it is. What is the thing that he wants to make his own, which he has not yet obtained? Go back to 3:10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Now we're making some progress here. Paul presses on to attain the resurrection of the dead, to make sure that he perseveres. Make no mistake about it, you're in Christ. Nothing separates you. You don't keep yourself in, but the demonstration that you are in is that you persevere. Now, how does all of this affect the way that we read the phrase, forgetting what lies behind? We got to go back even further. Paul left something behind. What has made up his life, according to which he must die, Philippians 3:10, so that he might attain the resurrection? You got to go back to verse 3. Context, context, context. Paul claims that he's a part of the circumcision group, those who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. He was a believer in doing stuff. This is in contrast to the dogs and evildoers who mutilate the flesh, Philippians 3:2. So the circumcision that he's talking about here is not about the cutting, but about putting no confidence in the flesh. Paul had much reason for putting confidence in the flesh. Remember what he said in Philippians 3, our same chapter, verses 4 to 6. Circumcised on the eighth day, an Israelite from the tribe of Benjamin, an excellent Jew, a keeper of the law, a zealous persecutor of false religions, a blameless adherent to the righteousness of the law. He was striving to achieve his own salvation. That is the context. Now in verse 7, but whatever gain I had, however good I was, all loss for the sake of Christ. I count everything as garbage because I'm knowing Jesus Christ my Lord. I've suffered all these things, count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Paul was rejecting his pedigree. I'm leaving that behind, not all thoughts, not all memories. I'm leaving behind the notion that I can work my way to heaven. This is not to forget everything, but it is to forget his self-righteous pedigree. All of his accomplishments, all of it, all that I thought it was wrong. I'm forgetting that system. So this verse is not about forgetting your failures or regrets, even though you've had a few. These verses highlight grace. And it's about thinking about what God has done to save the self-righteous and to prepare a place for us. This is not about just forgetting everything. This is about forgetting any efforts to earn God's favor through my own works. That is specifically in the context that Paul had in mind. This is not a general forgetting all stuff. This is forget trying to work your way to heaven. Now, if you think that somehow is a lesser promise than your perhaps previous understanding of the verse, I would suggest to you it is a greater verse of comfort. We've been saved by grace alone, faith alone, in Christ alone. We forget our efforts. This is a better promise. This is Wretched Radio.